I can find it. So, anyway. So, Oakland Youth Policy Builders is a program, well, I already said that, but its mission is to improve the relationship between the youth and policymakers. That's who the people make the rules or the laws. So, yeah, we want to improve on that. And, so we're here today to hear Dr. Rios's uncovering through restorative justice, the school to prison pipeline, and the power of transformation. So that's why we're here today. So we want to start the day off with a performance by the youth from Babies.
Green, so you can see it engraved in the pavement of my hood, and my hood is open. And in Oakland, we are born with scars like birth wounds. Scars brought onto our backs, along with being lashes. The exits to mark the spot for future lashes. We're being shot from the back, it's running from where the past has left us trapped in these boxes. So now we boxing back, trying to leave the box behind our backs. But boxes creates more boxes in the hood. We're confused. And so we metaphorically box each other. With black on black boxes, commit black on black violence over blocks, and innocent is shot. Now sometimes wishfulness didn't fly straight. It seems aim is never straight. Clocking changes with sequence to take innocent lives, competing against the dangers of the streets. Now they can relate, they feel unsafe, and unknowingly seeking the reaper to fake death. So the real killers won't reap them and just place those thoughts on the left. I've always wanted curving bullets, but once they might actually hit their targets. But in spite of all the violence, my hood was found by the Panthers, who gave birth to a new breed of revolutionaries we call oak openers. Now our oak trees are gone, but the engine still resonates with youth like me. So we can return to our roots to give life to new seeds. And one day we'll find Oakland trees sprout from the concrete, revitalizing every piece of our history. We may have lost and repeated to the historically lost to cover the historical costs of ignorance. And we will do this until we all carry our bees like honeybees and take that sweet nectar back to our community. Thank y'all so much.
Don't allow society to hold you hostage again. Stand on your own 2 feet this time. Walk with confidence. And if any of you know this, I love you. But I don't like what you're doing to yourself. See you when I reach 26. Thank you.
Next up, I want to introduce a city council member, born and raised in Oakland. He attended St. Elizabeth High School and graduated from UC Berkeley with a business degree. And he can often be seen cleaning up with the community, doing a great job. He believes an efficient city government is key or is essential to economic growth and well-managed functional city. I'm sorry. But introducing Noel Gallo.
Buenas tardes. It's great to be alive and to be living in this itty-bitty city we know as Oakland, California. This is a beautiful city.
Yeah.
You know what, I grew up in the city and did the Hoppers and used to be Hamilton in those days. But now it's Calvin Simmons, United for Success. And had an opportunity to attend St. Elizabeth. At that time, the Catholic schools were recruiting us out of the middle schools to attend their high schools. Because they still do admission without us in other schools. But anyways, I'm really honored to be here. Thanks to PUEBLO for the invitation. Before I introduce the guest speaker, I think we have to recognize we're in a real special place. For me, this is perhaps the most sacred place there is on the planet. When you visit a school, when you visit whether it's an elementary, high school, or university level, it's a super special place. Because not only is it for our family, but in our American society, in this country, we are judged and valued by the number of degrees. You have your high school diploma, pretty cool. I mean, you get to some places. You have your university degree, you must know something. You get your PhD, like the doctor has, you must be super smart. But I think that the reason I say that is you look at this gymnasium at Castlemont High School in East Oakland. I really want to thank those that, like Agnes, that live in Oakland, continue to be here in Oakland and are paying your taxes to make sure that we have these schools. Because through you, your neighbors and yourselves were able to pay what they call a initial B fund upon that made this available. We rebuilt Castlemont School, we rebuilt Tech, we rebuilt Oakland High School, we rebuilt the colonies. And we're about to invest $100 million to rebuild Fremont High School from the ground all the way. And I want to publicly thank you for that. Because in this city, young people, in this city, we have a school on just about every block. All you gotta do is get up, show up, do your work, listen to your teachers, do your work. And it'll open up a great deal of doors for us. So I just need to thank our residents, our citizens at Owen, and make this possible. And really, I value that kind of support because I'll tell you, we even have a swimming pool at Castlemont. You know that? Because we used to complain that we couldn't swim. But we have a brand new, I don't think they use it. You go to a climate school, you ever seen a climate swimming pool? It's just an empty hole on the floor, on the ground. Nobody even uses it. So we got to take advantage of what the voters have given us, and they've given us a great deal, but we just have to value what we have, use it, and establish a discipline. But anyways, I'm here. I'm honored to introduce Dr. Rios. And Dr. Rios grew up here in East Oakland. Went to Highland Elementary School. Everybody knows where Highland is, right down the street. Went to Elmhurst Middle School. I don't know how you wound up in McClyon's, but he went to McClyon's. And he said he didn't last too long on the climax, and he went on to Berkeley, and then he went on to Cal State, where he received his undergraduate degree. Then he went on to where I went, and good number of all of us went to UC Berkeley, and he received his doctorate degree, and currently he's a professor at the University of Santa Clara. And outstanding, so we got to recognize and applaud you for your work. So let's give him a big applause. Because this exemplifies what we all grew up in this city. At least those of us that grew up in this area or on the 23rd Avenue, where I grew up at, we clearly can identify with his background. He says here, he encountered growing up poor, fatherless, in a gang, incarcerated, robbed out, and without hope. His riveting and heartbreaking story teaches us all about the power of dreams, beliefs, and mentoring in his life of marginalized young people. He reflects on his own personal transformation and discusses how his success of returning to school, going to college, and acquiring a PhD can be replicated by young people with the support of teachers, mentors, and this super special group we know as parents. And his story is like many of us' story. I was born to a 16-year-old mom. I never knew who my dad was. You know what? I was very lucky to have a grandmother. And so I was brought up by my grandmother. I grew up with a family of two brothers and a sister. One of my brothers, right there in front of Freeman High School, he chose to get involved in what we call challenging. What some moms will call make poor choices, let's call it that. You know, at the age of 18, he shot some kid on the head right in front of Freeman High School over a broken stereo. My sister, younger sister, she got cut out of Freeman High School with all the drugs and so forth. But one of the things that I was very fortunate is to have a grandmother. And my grandmother always taught me, and I never forgot, she said, it's not what you say, it's what you do and how you do it. But she also always says, Noel, don't you let anyone ever tell you that you're poor. Because the minute you start believing that you're poor, you start thinking poor, acting poor, and behaving poor. God gave you the intelligence and the abilities that anyone else has. You just need the tools and the information to get ahead. And that's why you gotta get up and go to school. And I think this is what this country offers us if we're taking advantage of that you know, we all can get PhDs and be at the place of Dr. Rios is. But it requires us discipline and hard work. And but with that, I'm so honored to have Dr. Rios here with us to not only reflect on his development, but also to give us words of hope and encouragement so we can rise to the next level, because I believe Oakland's going to be a great city. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm very honored. It feels good to be home. You know, the last couple months I've been in Chicago twice, Pennsylvania, UCLA, Irvine. Been to a lot of places, and I show up and I do it Oakland style, you know, I just show up and handle my business. But when I'm home in Oakland, you know, it's like showing up to your house and you're trying to put up this identity that you have on the outside, but in reality you just need to recognize that you're just a child in the household. And that you need to bow down to the powers that be. And so when I'm in Oakland, I'm very humbled because you are the powers that be. You are the service providers that are on the ground, day to day, working with the youth. You are the young people with those beautiful struggles that continue day to day to show grit, resilience, and adversity. And overcoming that adversity. You are those teachers that get piled on and piled on a bunch of students that all need support, and you struggle, but somehow you get through your day, and somehow you manage to teach us. Some of you criminalize us, but most of you teach us. So, I'm very honored to be here. Let me see, show of hands. Teachers, raise your hand. How many teachers I got in here? Nice. You're up to the teachers. All right. Students, how many students? I said students. All right. Nice. Welcome, welcome. Thank you for being here. Do I got middle school students up in here? Yeah, raise your hand. Youth organizers. Organizers that. All right. Service providers, youth programs, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All right, wonderful, wonderful. How about members of my family? Raise your hand if you're a member of my family. Where's the Rios at? I do have a member. Okay, so my mom may be here today. And my little niece, who's a UC Berkeley student, you know, we have, combined my niece and I, we have about 100 cousins and uncles and nephews that are all like our age or younger, my age or younger. And it, out of those 100 or so, about 5 of us have college degrees. And so it's important for us to support her, right, to get through. So this summer she's going off to study abroad. She's going to go to a summer program for research in the East Coast. So anyway, today, you know, everyone's throwing a cooperacha, right? So it's like everyone's going to show up. My mom made birria. People are going to, you know, give us some money to help her out on her trip and her studies.
Where
we're going. West Oakland, the lower bottom, former headquarters of the Black Panther Party, and my DOB sent this house. And that's how we roll in Oakland, right? This was the headquarters of the Black Panther Party. My uncle did it, and he bought the house. And then they would do the bus tour every year, stop in front of his house. And he'd be in the front drinking a Bud Light. And we go in there, and they had a little tunnel, and they had GVP Newton's wicker chair. Can we take it yet? Give me some. Yo sé que es eso. Right? When I was growing up over here on 88 East Street, I was, I don't know, like 8, 9 years old, and I saw a procession. I didn't know what it was. They were holding up a casket. They were walking down the street. And they were chanting, "Long live QVP, African people will be free." And I'm on my bicycle. And I tag along. I don't have a clue what I'm doing, but I remember that chant to this day. QEP's procession. The guys that brought me up, the streets of Oakland, the older guys, they were former Black Panthers. That's how we roll in Oakland, right? This is the connections we made with each other as different peoples. And so nowadays, right, today I'll talk a little bit about restorative justice, but nowadays, it's like a hot topic, right? District administrators, restorative justice, National Institute of Justice, restorative justice, Obama, restorative justice. You know where restorative justice came from? You all know where it came from because I'm preaching to the choir. It's an indigenous philosophy for millennia. Different cultures throughout the globe practice restorative justice. But all of a sudden, it's like the hot thing to do, right? And so it's being co-opted. It's being co-opted by the system. But there is hope. We have people like Simon Davis, who's doing great work. George Galvez and Courage, and many, many more people, right, that are doing amazing work in Oakland and in the Bay Area to really, you know, change the way we look at young people. And I'll talk about that in my presentation. There's my older brother, like, who actually raised me, and I'm just bringing his children in. Hey, brother. At age 15, he went to work full time to provide for the family. And finished his high school diploma even though he was working full time. And he's never stopped working. And so, you know, it's a beautiful thing, right, that we find ways to survive. And I'll talk a little bit about that today, too. So, I'll just tell you a too short story, but I'll say that at another time. So, can we get the screen down, please? Can we get the PowerPoint warmed up, please? Well, meanwhile, I guess I'll tell you. So, my mom used to send us to the store on 88 to go buy tortillas. And she gave me money, and then I would stop by the East Bay Dragon spot, the motorcycle club, and there was a guy rapping in there, a young guy. I was little, and he was saying a lot of bad words. And, you know, kind of got into it, you know, just like, and then eventually they started selling little tapes, cassette tapes out of there. So I spent the tortilla money on a cassette tape. Too short cassette tape. I ended up getting to do it one day. And my mom had this belt, El Cinturón de la Víbora. The snake belt. And every time she hit you with it, it would leave a big snake mark printed on your culo, man. So, back to the topic at hand. Grit. What does it mean to have grit? Oh, there's my sister-in-law. I better stop cussing. Hi, Rana. Rana also raised me. She's definitely been a big influence in my adolescence, and I was getting in trouble. So for me, like seeing how people survive and taking that survival and then teaching these young people how they can use those same survival skills in different contexts. So when this young man gives his beautiful poem, right, about already having sort of a factor of resilience, right, carrying those pieces of change, and we just get confused and we end up with a piece in a, you know, waste, he said it more eloquently. Right, we're just sort of, the system has ways of confusing us about how we prove our adulthood, or our manhood, or our worthiness in society, because we've been systematically stripped of our dignity over time from very young ages. And I find that among some of the young men in my studies. So before I continue, I'll show you a couple short clips of some of the work we've been doing.
Now, another in our series on the nation's high school dropout crisis. Tonight, one man's journey from gang member and dropout to professor, and his efforts to keep other young men from making his mistakes. Bryce Suarez has our American graduate story.
My name is Victor Rios. In 1994, this was Meiji. I was introduced to the nation in the Frontline documentary. I was a gang member, a juvenile delinquent, and a high school dropout.
But in the 18 years that followed, Victor Rios earned his high school diploma, finished college, earned a PhD from the University of California at Berkeley, and wrote two books on his life and his research on juvenile delinquency. He now teaches sociology at UC Santa Barbara and helps at-risk youth navigate the perils of adolescence. Rios is also a family man with a wife, Rebecca, and three children. Life is constantly busy.
To be this far into the future, I feel like I've lived a lifetime.
Keep that theme in mind, two lifetimes. Keep that idea in mind. Is it possible, right, for people to live lifetimes?
His duties as a college professor and high school researcher all the while studying and mentoring at this young man in Santa Barbara.
My name is Gallo, 19 years old. I was born and raised in Santa Barbara, and I've been labeled as a gang member down here.
If I hadn't been put to real, I honestly think I would have gone to jail.
Miguel asked us not to use his last name. He first met Professor Rios about 2 years ago when he took part in a sociology study.
I felt like I could relate to him. He knew what we are about, you know? And he knows where we come from. He knows how to come at us, you know? Or what they would expect to come at us.
Miguel's two older brothers were in gangs. He had his first interaction with the juvenile justice system at the age of 12 after he stole a bike. Miguel never really liked the class and eventually left school for good without a high school diploma. Now that he's joined Rios's program, though, Miguel now aims to complete his GED and hopes to one day become a mechanic.
I've seen Miguel grow over the last couple of years. I've seen him become a leader in the community.
Miguel knows he's still a work in progress.
I mean, it's not like you're asleep, you know? The belly one night and wake up the next day, I have wings, you know? I mean, everyone's got room for change for the better, you know? And I'm so young, I'm so got a lot of room for change.
And he's encouraging others to do the same. Miguel is now helping his friend Hector, a 15-year-old sophomore, avoid him 16.
He's at my back. I've had his brother. He, like, helped me out a lot. He encouraged me, told me to stay in school, just get over with, and help me out in the future. And, yeah, I trust him.
It's a pay-it-forward strategy that Victor Rios, the gang member turned university professor, still can't believe he put in motion.
During the time I was on the street as a teenager, someone approached me, an angel came to me, and said, hey, hang in there, man, because when you're 34, you're going to have a beautiful family, a wonderful household, a great job, you're going to be a PhD from Berkeley, you're going to have written 2 books, and you'll be an award-winning professor. I would have laughed. So now it's my job to let them know that it's not a joke, to let them know that I believe in them the way that my teacher believed in me, to let them know that there are second chances.
Rios is now working on a book that's examining the achievement gap at Santa Barbara High School.
Our next story profiles a photographer.
So, 2 lifetimes, right? Oh, and by the way, there's a couple of my students from UC Santa Barbara that are here today that helped out with the project and were instrumental in helping them to mentor some of the young men. It'll solve that maybe, so thank you for help. My first book, Punish, was in Oakland. I followed the young men in Oakland. And actually, one of the young men that is in the book, right, when I met him, I won't spoil it because you have to read this part. When I met him, people were after him. I mean, he had stories about people doing crazy things to his house to try to get him. Remember that? And today he's a PhD student at the Wright Institute. Is that right? At the Wright Institute in psychology. Yes, is a beautiful family man, is getting into politics in Oakland, you know, it's going to take us to change us, right? And so, Randy, thanks for everything you've done for me and for yourself and for your community. So this whole idea, right, of 2 lifetimes is an important concept, right? It's about second chances. You know, restorative justice is a lot of talk, you know, and some of us, some people do it really, really well, and some people, like I said, sort of just co-opted as a bandit approach. So we have to be critical, right, of what approaches are working and what approaches we need to
make sure to address, right? Systematic approaches are important. And I'll get into what that means for me. Right? So here is this image, you know, I have a cop dragging me out of, you know, school. And then here in this image, there's a, you know, an administrator patting a cop in the back. He's graduating. He's now, you know, gang-tied in school. There's zero tolerance rules. You pretty much get expelled from school. So I was, you know, pretty much about to be expelled. And this is part of a larger system, right, that in the last 30 years we've changed our discipline policies. That's my nephew, so I guess family is here present today, I guess. And so we've changed our discipline policies to bring in more police officers, more policing, more surveillance for schools. Some of us might say, well, that's to protect the students. But in reality, when we see sort of the blending in of policing tactics, policing strategies, policing resources into educational institutions and youth development institutions, it becomes problematic because police officers are not trained to properly help young people out. They're trained to apprehend suspects, right? And so this is a crisis in Oakland that I found and punished. But it's a crisis throughout the country when dealing with inner city young people. So are these young men at promise, or are they at risk? Raise your hand if they're at promise.
Yeah.
Raise your hand if they're at risk. You guys are too liberal. Both?
Both.
You guys. Anybody watching the news tonight, KTVU, this picture pops up. Young man, 14-year-old, has a Hennessy bottle in his hand. One of them has a blunt in his mouth. Are they at promise or are they at risk?
Risk.
You're watching the news, you're an everyday Bay Area. They're at risk. And that becomes a problem because how many of us work for a program, have been part of the program, been in a program, heard people talk about programs for at-risk youth? Raise your hand. Right? That becomes a problem because what you label someone determines how you'll treat them. So if you label someone as a risk, you're going to treat them as a risk. And what do we do with risky populations in our society today?
Camera on,
what else?
Isolate.
Arrest them.
Isolate.
Isolate, how do we isolate them?
Jail.
We get rid of them, right? And we, good intentioned people, are part of the process when we're talking about these young people as risks, as actors. So in order to solve the problem, we have to even check the way we do language and the way we label. So we invest too much on punishment and not enough on purpose and rewards. That's what restorative justice is, right? To invest in purpose, giving people a purpose or a reward, right? For leading a positive trajectory. And there's a crisis in our country. One out of every three young black men in America are either incarcerated or under the criminal justice system. Under supervision of the criminal justice system. And did you know that in the state of California there are 22,000 college-age black men in college and 44,000 college-age black men in prison? Twice as many in prison than there are in college. That's a crisis. And it's because of the way we've decided to treat, to rehabilitate our young people on the margins. All right, 2.2 million people are locked up in America. Half of them are African American. African Americans make up 14% of the total U.S. population. It's a crisis. Latinos are sandwiched in between, right? Not too far behind. African Americans, not as drastically impacted by incarceration. And we have to acknowledge it. So, for the first time in the history of the state of California, we invest more on prisons than we do on public, higher public education. Look at this. It used to be that we spent that much of the general funds on higher ed. Now we spend that much. It used to be we spent that much on prisons. Now we spend that much. So our priorities have changed. Politicians have built careers around cracking down on crime. And unfortunately, we bought into that fear of crime, voted for them, voted for the policies. And before we know it, it comes back and bites us in the behind. Because now we have exorbitant college loans. Our kids can't get to college. Affirmative action is banned because people get resentful that there's a small program because there's not enough room for everyone. And it's not because we're taking over the system, it's because the system has just completely begun to collapse because we're spending more money somewhere else in prisons. So this would be a healthy model, right? And we could have debates about this, but this is what a healthy model would look like. We need lots of prevention. Right, we need to talk to little preschoolers about life skills and resilience and grit. Right, and we need intervention. Right, and that's like intervening in the lives of young people that are caught up on the streets, that are not doing well in school. At prom is young people, right? And then some would argue we need some suppression for that 3% of that population that's out there committing violence. Right, what that suppression look like? We could debate it, but we need some solution. Right? And that's what I found in Punish, that the police in Oakland were so busy catching the little fish, harassing the kids in front of the liquor stores, that they were letting the shark get away, which was some of the shot callers hiding in the background. Right? And the community knows who those shot callers are. But somehow it's the kids being dragged away for smoking weed, you know, small offenses. We need to address that. That's a crisis of substance abuse, but we have to do it in the right way. So we've kind of cracked down through suppression, 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 suppression. So this is what Punish looked at. What does it mean to grow up in a time where we invest more on prisons than we do on education? I mean, now I'm doing education studies and I'm at the schools and I'm asking that about teachers. Like, what happens when you underfund teachers? We're over here blaming the teachers. Hold them accountable. Evaluate them. Take their tenure away. It's like, really? We're not funding them. We're not educating them. We're not resourcing them. And we're trying to pin all the blame on them all of a sudden. And then there's just more images of policing in, what are we drinking?
Arizona.
You sure about that? Arizona? I had a college student say to me, "Well, it looks like you're drinking Four Locos." I'm like, "No, we're not drinking Four Locos. We're full of Four Locos up there. We're not drinking Four Locos. We're drinking Arizona." A few minutes later, this young man gets pulled out by a gang task force officer, pulls pulls off his t-shirt to check the gang tattoos, humiliates him. I say, officer, what happened? And he said, it looked like you guys are drinking in public. So all this pretense policing, stop and frisk, right, to try to prevent crime, but it just creates this resentment in young people, and it empowers them to lead life in the wrong direction sometimes. This young man, Tyrell, here in Oakland, in fifth grade, he's harassed by police for being too tall. I said, what do you mean by that, Tyrell? He said, you know, I would be like walking to school, right, and the officer would be like, hey, come here, I'm gonna search you. Officer, I'm in fifth grade. Why are you gonna search? You don't look like you're in fifth grade. You're too tall. You look like a drug dealer. Let me search you. And he got searched and searched and searched. Then in sixth grade, his teacher calls the cops on him. In eighth grade, he decides to sell drugs because he says, if I'm gonna be treated as a criminal, I might as well reap the benefits. Mother's evicted from public housing because we don't invest in public housing. And she ends up on the street trying to survive. She ends up addicted to crack. I record 21 police stops just while I'm hanging out with him in 3 years. That's not, when I ask him, how often does police stop you? He doesn't want to tell me. It's like, I lost track. Now, this day, he's mourning for his little cousin who was shot by the crack dealer in the alley there. More policing pictures. Policing. Now, let's start talking about solutions. In Missouri, they spend $48,000 per year at juvenile facilities for young people. It's a lot of money, right? It's a lot. $48,000. It's a lot. California, we spend more than the national average to lock up one young person. And this is the treatment in California. Concrete walls. In Missouri, it looks like a regular school. California, we got them locked down, isolated. In Missouri, you have, this isn't a prison level. This is a counselor teaching the young person about conflict resolution. He's a peacemaker. Because when the youngsters get into fights, he intervenes and he builds peace, makes a peace circle. It works sometimes it doesn't. But you don't have prison guards having to pepper spray them down to solve the problem. So restorative justice, like I mentioned earlier, it's an indigenous idea, right? It's about sustainability. And it's a movement, and let's not forget this, it's a movement going back to the freedom struggles of the 1960s. The Black Panther Party, they were demanding dignity. Dignity in the way they were treated by authority figures. And so you have people that leave a legacy behind. Angela Davis, Fonda Davis, and then now, right? Fonda Davis is doing this restorative justice work. Important work. So what happens is, right, when the people demand freedom, restorative justice, free breakfast for children, right, in the 1960s, the police force looks like this. By 1995, it's looking like this. And by Occupy Oakland, it's looking like this. This is where money is going. And so, it's going to take more than one person with a legacy, or more than two or three organizations, more than just PUEBLO doing a lot of this kind of work. It's going to take a lot more. I remember hanging out on the streets of Oakland on 94th and International, when I was 15, 16 years old, middle of the night, 2 in the morning, on a school night, dropped out of school. And there was moments when people would drive by and shoot at us, and I was so out of it that I would just throw up my hands like, I didn't even care. And I remember wishing, in those late night conversations with my friends, right, those of us that were gang threats, right, to law enforcement, right, remember having conversations about one day wanting people to come together in this part of Oakland to look out for us, to give us a space, to give us a voice, to hear us out. I didn't call it restorative justice, but I was dreaming about organizations and groups like the ones that you now run. And so I've seen progress in the world. Still young people are out there left behind, but there's a lot of promise. So Oakland's not at risk, is what? At promise. Oakland has a lot of promise, right? And it's about benchmarking those best practices throughout this town, those organizations that are already doing great work, and the people already doing great work to continue moving forward. So I'm very, very excited. So, this is a project.
You see, young people, sometimes your family is broken.
Sorry about that. So, I miss home. I did a project in Santa Barbara for a few years, and then this past summer, you know, I went into LA, went into Watts. I'm looking for places like home, and young people like the young people at home. So I went into Watts this summer with a group of my students, and we developed a curriculum, we call it GRIT, Generating Resilience to Inspire Transformation. And this is a clip of some of the stuff that we did with these young people.
You see, young people, sometimes your family struggle. And sometimes in that struggle, you find unhealthy ways to forget about that struggle, to deal with that struggle. Drugs, the streets, the hustle, abuse, self-abuse, self-hate, self-doubt, not believing in yourself, not signing up for this great program. You know what? School is not about just you. It's about your community that has struggled. It's about your community and bringing your community up. And this is one of your opportunities to do it.
Saying that again, that would be the most difficult because, I don't know, like, being out of there is not that easy, you know, because you may have stopped, but your enemies always remember who you are, your face, or you can't change it. You may got enough of that lifestyle, but like, your enemies are still there, they're gonna forget about you. To me, I look at the streets like a sport. It was a sport because, I don't know, a lot of things you do, but at the same time you put your life at risk.
Come on, try to put your feet over. Come on. Hey, don't drop this one, go down.
Hey, man, I can't do it.
Yeah, you can't do it. Hey, lift up your left leg. Yeah, grab off of it and lift up your left leg.
Yeah.
So, come on. Just take three steps, bro.
Come on, I got this shit!
they took our mugshot picture, they took our fingerprints. So it was just like, and we had to go to court, and my mom was like really, really mad at me, my dad. And I got kicked out for that night, but I was like, you know what, I'm going to go back to my house, I just got kicked out. I'm going to jail, and everything was good that day. I think it was just, I don't regret it, I think it was just funny that day. Yeah, it's something that you're going to remember forever.
You made it into the
okay.
I want it.
You want it? Just to see what it's like? I know you're tough. I know you can handle it. But you ever seen on TV or YouTube how they process chickens and other animals? The slaughterhouse?
Oh, yeah.
It's like a slaughterhouse, you know? There's bodies and bodies and bodies stacked on each other. And the way they set you guys up, the way they put you in there and stack you up like that on each other, it makes you do animalistic things that you wouldn't ordinarily do if you weren't locked away.
Why don't you do this? Why don't you become a college professor that studies in jail, and then you get to go visit without having to be an inmate? It's going to take us.
We don't speak to our people. So, where did I get this grit? Where did I get the curriculum? From my PhD at Berkeley?
No. No.
Did Berkeley give me that curriculum? You tell me.
No.
No.
Okay.
Did UCSB give me that curriculum?
No.
The streets of Oakland gave me that curriculum. You gave me that curriculum. And let me tell you why. My brother had to pick me up from Juby a couple of times on San Leandro. He's been San Leandro for 150 years. You remember that, JT?
Yeah.
And every time he picked me up, he'd be like, what's up? I'm like, what's up? And I didn't want to walk in front of him. But I did. Because he would slow down, make me walk in front of him. And then, boom! Right? But I was too caught up, you know? And it took him, his support. It took my teacher's support. It took her connecting me with college students, like Martin, that I was standing next to in the video. He was a UC Berkeley student. He mentioned, he ran a place called, he rented a place and he illegally painted all these murals of like Aztec gods and pyramids on his walls. And he called it Chicano headquarters. And it was a refuge for me. And we would hang out there, and he was broke. But he would always have grilled cheese sandwiches. And he'd give me his last grilled cheese sandwich. Because he knew that he was investing in me. He was from East LA. We had nothing in common. But he knew that I was a kid that was in need, that needed that connection. And he brought it to me. And then all kinds of other college students started to mention me. And then before you know it, Proposition 187 kicks in. And these college students are mentoring us, right? Anti-immigration. Anti-immigrant proposition. They start mentoring us, guiding us, teaching us about our history, teaching us about our culture. We're hanging out downtown Oakland. Was it Local 28? Local 28 and the union. We're having meetings, and then we start to organize walk-ons, high school walk-ons. We walk out of all our high schools, and we take over the park system. And we end up in Hayward at a park. And there's North Daniels and Sue Daniels there. And we brought brown bandanas. And we hit up the North Daniels, we hit up the Sue Daniels. And we said, will you trade them in just for today? That was a hard job. But we took all the bandanas, we put them and tied them all together. They all were wearing brown bandanas for the day. It empowered us. And that's what I'm saying, like, it's the power of grassroots movements. It's the power of youth workers. It's the power of mentors.
the power of teachers. This teacher knew she couldn't connect with me too much, so she connected me with a young group of students, college students. So I ended up graduating from high school on time and with my class with the support of this network. And right when I'm about to graduate, my teacher says to me, "Victor, I knew you could do it. Now it's time to go to college." College, me? Man, what is this teacher smoking thinking? I'm going to college. I want to be a mechanic. She talked to the college students. They convinced me. Give it a shot. I apply. I get a letter. Congratulations. You've been admitted to California State University Hayward. The next paragraph read, "You've been admitted under probationary status." I said, "Probation? I'm already on probation. Never mind." But they were talking about a different kind of probation. Like if you get a C or below, they'll kick you out.